Following the defeat of Morgoth at the end of the First Age, Sauron was commanded by the Herald of Manwë, Éowyn, to return to Aman and receive judgment. Instead, Sauron, out of shame and fear of humiliation, hid in Middle-earth, eventually rising into power and claiming to be a representative of his defeated master in the Second Age. By the end of the Third Age, Sauron claimed to be Morgoth Returned. What did Sauron mean by this? This video will attempt to answer the question, why did Sauron claim to be Morgoth in the Third Age? When he found how greatly his knowledge was admired by all other rational creatures, and how easy it was to influence them, his pride became boundless. By the end of the Second Age, he assumed the position of Morgoth's representative. By the end of the Third Age, though actually much weaker than before, he claimed to be Morgoth Returned. Despite Sauron's pride being boundless, he would know in his heart that he wasn't actually Morgoth, at least when he made the claim. Claiming to be such a figure would aid Sauron in his ambition to be worshipped and feared as a god-king of Middle-earth. One could argue that his experiences leading up to that point would have fed his ego in a way where he would feel comfortable claiming such a title as Morgoth Returned. It is perhaps a title of greater arrogance than Lord of Men or Lord of the Earth. The title Morgoth Returned encompasses all of those other titles, as Morgoth, the first Dark Lord, also claimed to be the King of Arda and the Lord of all those within it. We must not forget that Sauron himself was a tyrant. Sauron had gone the way of all tyrants, beginning well, at least on the level that while desiring to order all things according to his own wisdom, he still at first considered the economic well-being of other inhabitants of the earth. But he went further than human tyrants in pride and the lust for domination, being in origin an immortal angelic spirit. Sauron desired to be a god-king, and was held to be this by his servants. If he had been victorious, he would have demanded divine honour from all rational creatures, and absolute temporal power over the whole world. Sauron went further than the capabilities of any human tyrant. As an immortal spirit, he would desire divine honour from all rational creatures, holding supreme power over the world. His ego and pride had grown to immense proportions, greater than mortal proportions. Tolkien is telling us that due to Sauron's immortal and divine origin, he is grander than evil kings of men or dictators, a figure of incomprehensible malice, ego, and will. Sauron served Morgoth and knew he wasn't literally Morgoth, but now possibly saw himself as Morgoth in the sense that he was that great, that powerful, and that worshipful. Imagine a human conqueror growing in power and claiming to be Alexander the Great or Genghis Khan. It's a boastful claim that speaks of the ego and power held by the individual and how he wishes to be perceived. Sauron knew of the might of his master, the influence and power he held over the world. Who else would he claim to be, as his own ego swells and his enemies weaken? Sauron was not a sincere atheist, but he preached atheism because it weakened resistance to himself, and he had ceased to fear God's action in Arda. To wean one of the God-fearing from their allegiance, it is best to propound another unseen object of allegiance and another hope of benefits. Propound to him a lord who will sanction what he desires and not forbid it. Sauron, apparently a defeated rival for world power, now a mere hostage, can hardly propound himself. But as the former servant and disciple of Melkor, the worship of Melkor will raise him from hostage to high priest. Here we're being given a glimpse into the mind of Sauron, from a time when he was a hostage in Numenor. He corrupted the god-fearing people to a path of darkness, a path to Melkor, and one that strayed further from Eru. At this time, Sauron was unable to claim to be a god after surrendering willingly to Ar-Pharazôn. After he aids in the downfall of Numenor, he stands in defiance of the wrath of God and the powers of the West, and is killed as the sea takes him and the world is changed. Sauron undergoes a change in the process. He loses his physical form, fleeing as a spirit with the ruling ring he had now become dependent on for domination. He returns to Mordor with greater pride and arrogance, still surviving in Middle-earth after an act of divine intervention. He sees himself as a godlike figure, unable to shield his malicious will through a fair form. He is now a terrible and dark tyrant for all the world to see. After his return and rise to power once again into the Dark Lord of Mordor, he now claims to be Morgoth Returned. He can say he was victorious, the bringer of death to those men who challenged him. He is now the dreaded figure of the First Age, a figure of infamy and legend to those mortals who were not alive to witness events. He not only demands worship, but deserves worship. One who has ownership over Middle-earth, now apparently abandoned by Eru and the Valar, and one who can now shape it freely to his own will. Parts of the world that had been corrupted by Morgoth long ago will now swear instant fealty and undying loyalty to Sauron, their God King. Those challenging him will meet their end, if they dare challenge him.